Amen. Your love goes on and on and on and on, and what a way to start our service this morning. So we are very blessed to have all of you here and joining us this morning. I'm Jane Timmerman, and I'll give our announcements this morning. We are grateful to have been named the best place to worship by the Aiken Standard and all the people of Aiken and all of you here. For the second time in 3 years, this great community has chosen St. John's as a place they most enjoy worshiping. So thank you, Aiken, and thank you, St. John's, for the privilege of serving and worshiping God with you, and we are very blessed to be here and worshiping with you and serving us in worshiping. So thank you. Our Groves Children Ministry will meet on July 17th from 5 to 6:30 here at St. John's for a hot dog supper, games, and a fun time of fellowship. Parents will be receiving an email that will give them instructions on how to register. Our 7th through 8th grade youth will meet tonight in the gym from 5 to 6:30 for a fun time of kickball in the gym and ice cream. Monday, there will be eating at Jimmy John's, bring your own money. And then please note that we will be beginning a new 12-week grief share session that will begin August 17th at 3:45 here in the Faith Center. It is really wild. I can sing, but just speaking like this in front of people, I get so nervous. So it's really funny. Actually, it is. The new grief share session will be led by Reverend Butch. This is a wonderful and comforting program for those making the journey of grief. If you have any questions or would like to know more about the grief share, please call Reverend Butch in the church office. So now please stand and join us as Jeff leads us in The One Thing. Thank you.
Here I am in a river of questions. Can I pull my heart out to a listening ear? Well, I see this life, its valleys and mountains, and I think of all the roads that brought me here. Oh, that brought me here. Walking down the roads. Well, I question my reasons, this life I'm living, and I question our ability to judge wrong from right. And I question all the things I'd ever called certain, my race, my religion, my country, my mind. But the one thing I don't question is you really love me like you say you do. You love me like you say you do. So hold me. Come on, I need your love. Significance, meaning, or relevance. Does the work I'm doing really matter at all? Well, I question my friendships, alliance, dependence, or who will still be here when I fall? But the one thing I don't question is you. You really love me like you say you do. Yeah, the one thing I don't question. Change. Only one thing stays the same. All I know at the end of the day is your love remains. Only one thing doesn't change. Only one thing stays the same. All I know at the end of the day is your love remains. And the one thing I don't question is you. You really love me like you say you do. You're the one thing.
Please remain standing as we say what we believe in our affirmation of faith, the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and he's seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom shall have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in the one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come to end. Amen. Please be seated. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, good morning. Before I open this up with a word of prayer, I want to make one quick mention. We would ask that you all be in prayer for Dr. Tim and for Reverend Butch. Unfortunately, they both tested positive for COVID a couple days ago. So we are in prayer for them and for Cindy and for Karen. But we are thankful that we continue, the show continues on, right, Jane? But we're thankful to be able to be here and to be worshiping this morning. So at this time, friends, let us go before the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, this morning we come to you with humble hearts, seeking to hear your word of truth. May your message be spoken and be sung by our voices in this place. May your spirit fill our hearts to exceeding worship and praise. And may we respond in joyful thanksgiving for the grace that you extend to us each day so that we may be truly sanctified in you. You've started a work within us, Lord, and the work that you have begun, you will perfect to full completion through Christ. May it be that we seek him above all things. May we be ready to ask for grace and for healing in our hardest times. And although we are weary, Lord, although we've battled for so long, we continue to put our hope and our trust in you, our Savior and our Redeemer. We lift up those who are in need, those who are sick, and those who are seeking your hope in this time. For these things we pray in the mighty name of Jesus. And together we pray as he taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us for our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I invite our ushers to come forward for our time of tithes and offerings. Let's give as God has so graciously given to us.
Finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty. let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Finding myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise, and all that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet, to hear your voice. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay.
Well, friends, our scripture lesson this morning is found in the book of Amos, chapter 7, verses 7 through 17. Lots of sevens. Hear the word of God. This is what he showed me. The Lord was standing by a wall that had been built true to plumb, with a plumb line in his hand. And the Lord asked me, "What do you see, Amos?" "A plumb line," I replied. Then the Lord said, "Look, I am setting a plumb line among my people Israel. I will spare them no longer. The high places of Isaac I will destroy, and the sanctuaries of Israel will be ruined. With my sword I will rise against the house of Jeroboam." Then Amaziah, the priest of Bethel, sent a message to Jeroboam, king of Israel. "Amos is raising a conspiracy against you in the very heart of Israel. The land cannot bear all of his words, for this is what Amos is saying. Jeroboam will die by the sword, and Israel will surely go into exile away from their native land." Then Amaziah said to Amos, "Get out, you seer. Go back to the land of Judah. Earn your bread there and do your prophesying there. Don't prophesy anymore in Bethel, because this is the king's sanctuary and the temple of the kingdom." And Amos answered Amaziah, "I was neither a prophet nor the son of a prophet, but I was a shepherd, and I also took care of sycamore fig trees. But the Lord took me from tending the flock and said to me, 'Go, prophesy to my people Israel.' Now then, hear the word of the Lord. You say, 'Do not prophesy against Israel, and stop preaching against the descendants of Isaac.' Therefore, this is what the Lord says: Your wife shall become a prostitute in the city, and your sons and your daughters will fall by the sword. Your land will be measured up and divided, and you yourself will die in a pagan country. And Israel will surely go into exile away from their native land." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Well, I decided to mix things up a little bit this morning. today, you know, normally we always use the lectionary, myself, Dr. Tim, Reverend Butch. And if you're familiar with the lectionary, it gives you kind of a cycle, about a three-year cycle, that gets through most major portions of the Bible. So by the time you get to the end of the 3 years, you've covered a majority of the whole book. And every week you get four choices. You either get an Old Testament reading, a psalm, a gospel reading, or an epistle reading. Now, I could have gone with the familiar New Testament passage, but I thought, what's the fun in that? I decided to mix things up a little bit. I mean, it was a month ago I was ordained, so maybe it's just I'm feeling a little bit more confident today. But really, in all seriousness, I do believe, truly, I think the content of Amos's prophetic work in this passage really is not an unfamiliar story. I think we're very familiar, maybe not with necessarily the direct story of Amos and his struggle with the northern kingdom, but I've heard story after story that basically fits this very motif of what's going on. And just to prove the point, I know we have some parents here who I'm sure if we have parents present, or grandparents for that matter, I know I've got a room full of Disney movie aficionados. Actually, I take that back. I know I've got a room full of people who have heard the same soundtrack song over and over and over and over again. And there was a movie that came out last year, one of the their main, I guess, kind of frontline animated movies. It was a movie called Encanto. You might have seen the movie. I think it's such a wonderful movie, such a cute and original story. But what's interesting about this movie, not necessarily the story itself, but the fact that the soundtrack for the song, the main song for the movie Encanto called We Don't Talk About Bruno, was number one on Spotify for like months and was on all the radio waves, and people were almost obsessed over the song online. And the reason, I mean, it's a catchy song in and of itself, but it basically kind of tells the main premise of this movie. If you've never seen the movie Encanto, what it's about is it's about this family, this magical family. They live in this small village, and each member of the family, when they're at a very young age, is gifted with a special power, with some sort of remarkable ability. Some of it's great strength. One person has the ability to shapeshift, all these crazy kind of like superhero powers. But the character that's sung about in the song We Don't Talk About Bruno is the uncle of the main character of the story. And Bruno's special power is that he's able to predict the future. He's basically able to prophesy. And every time he predicts the future, or at least most of the time that he predicts the future, it usually is not a good thing. Usually whoever's involved with the prophecy has something bad happen to them. He predicted that a wedding was going to go wrong, that somebody was going to lose his hair, that somebody's pet was going to die. Every time he said or tried his power out, people got furious about him. So one day, he decided to just leave. He felt like he wasn't welcome in the small community. And that would have been a terrible thing because it was only Bruno who could warn the people about what was about to happen. The main story is the main character, her name is Mirabelle, trying to find Bruno, find the prophecy before everything that had given them their prosperity and their well-being would crumble away and fall into ruin. Now, how familiar does that story sound? I mean, okay, just put this into perspective. Encanto came out last year, right? It made over $230 million worldwide. $230 million worldwide. For a story, you basically got the source material from this right here. I mean, come on. It's remarkable how the text continues to live and to breathe, even in our culture when we least expect it. But it's interesting that prophecy, or the gift of prophecy, is just something that we find fascinating. It's something that just catches our attention. Dr. Tim did a Bible series in the book of Revelation. My Sunday school is doing Revelation as well. I've talked to so many people who are just fascinated with books like Revelation, like Daniel, like Ezekiel, those that show these remarkable images and visions of things that have not yet happened but are going to happen. We just think prophecy is just amazing, intriguing, fascinating. the ability to see into the future. Now, here's a caveat I want to put on our thoughts about prophecy. We love the future-telling part, but honestly, if it was just about future-telling, we would be reading the words of a seer or a diviner. We'd be reading a fortune-teller, basically. Everybody gets excited about the future-telling part, but what we don't get excited about is the thus saith the Lord part. When the prophet starts calling out names, when he starts pointing his finger at the people that they're prophesying to, when he stands up before the crowd and says, get your act together. You know, it's fun to read that in the text, but what often happens to the people who end up doing that, both in Amos's day and even in Jesus' day? It usually doesn't work out very well for the prophet. And we can understand that. I mean, in our time, with our kind of modern individualistic ears, if you have somebody who just gets up on a regular basis and all that they say is, get your act together or calamity is coming. Actually, there are a few people that already do that. What do? We don't pay them a bit of attention. We think they're crazy. And the most part is we don't want to believe, deep down inside, we don't want to anticipate something bad happen. We want to be optimistic about good things happening in the future. And it's sad because most of the time we'll neglect these texts, portions of Isaiah and Jeremiah, where there is a lot of a call to repentance. And it almost seems repetitive oftentimes to so many people's eyes and ears. But in sections like this is where we get some of the most profound wisdom in the entire Bible, is through the words of the prophets. Amos is a great read because his story is really the story of an outsider, something that we love as an underdog. God's nation at this point, it's not one kingdom that we're looking at. It's not just the nation of Israel. You see, after the time of Solomon, Jeroboam and Rehoboam split, the two kings split the nation into two, a northern kingdom and a southern kingdom. You had the northern kingdom that was called Israel. You had the southern kingdom that was called Judah. So much contention between these two nations, bickering over the two different points, literally split the kingdom into two different peoples. Does that sound familiar? Once again, this text is nothing new. Now, here's the interesting thing about Amos as a person. He was from the southern kingdom. He was from Judah. And when God came to him, he told him to go to the northern kingdom and to prophesy there. Now, Amos was, by all accounts, a reputable person. He was a successful farmer and a herdsman. He was very profitable in his profession. He took care of his people. Remember, this is an agricultural society. So if you take care of trees and of livestock, you're doing pretty well, especially if you are the main herdsman. He minded his business. He took care of his people. But then as God tends to do, he kind of messes all that up. God just shows up out of the blue and says, Amos, I want you to get up and I want you to go and preach to the northern kingdom. I want you to leave this prosperity that you have, and I want you to go somewhere where you're going to be hated. People are not going to like you. And I want you to tell them that if they don't get their act together, if they don't hear the words of my prophecy, if they don't see the truth that I've revealed to them, to their fathers and forefathers, they are going to see calamity. I want you to go speak to those people. You know about those people? You know, those people in any time, in any day, in any age, are the ones where we're sitting back and we're saying, you know, we have got things going on so great, but man, those people are holding us back. I have got everything figured out. We have every reason to be optimistic about it, but man, those people just keep on getting in the way. I've got it so figured out. I've got everything I need to know about today. I'm doing pretty well with my life, but man, that guy, that person, that group, that whatever is always thwarting what I'm trying to do. That is a message as old as time itself. Now, here's the interesting thing about the northern kingdom. Even though they were in a bitter rivalry with the southern kingdom, the northern kingdom was doing pretty well, all things considered. They were rolling in the good times. Their retirement plans were looking great. There were no major wars or conflicts. They had treaties and good ties with the nations around them. In their mind, what could possibly go wrong? We're religious. We have a high priest. We worship at Bethel. Bethel literally means the gate of God. What could go wrong? We are so good. Look at us. So successful. Have it all together. Now imagine if somebody from that place that you don't like comes up and says, y'all actually don't have it going all that great. In fact, you're doing terrible. In fact, the religion that you claim to be adhering to, the God that you claim to be faithful for, you have abandoned that God. You are worshiping other gods. Your religiosity is a sham. Because they were content to turn a blind eye to their unfaithfulness. It's interesting because every time you have a story about a prophet, I always think about our day, about if that very person were to show up today and say a very similar message, how would we in our present moment receive them? I mean, let's think about this for a second. Let's take a figure like John the Baptist. John the Baptist, who was prophesying and was anticipating the coming of Christ, the prophet of prophets, as far as we can tell. Imagine if John the Baptist were here today, and really think about it for a second. Camel hair all garbed over him, just one piece tied with a leather belt, on a strict diet of bugs and honey. He's out in the desert, preaching and railing and ranting and raving about some kingdom that's supposed to come when he knows nothing about what's going on in the geopolitical sphere. And he takes his followers and dunks them into the river, saying that they're washed and they're cleansed for the work of repentance. Now imagine if that guy showed up at our front door and started saying we need to get our acts together. How often would we want to listen to a character like that? Honestly, the profile of John the Baptist fits more of the profile of the character from the classic Saturday Night Live skit that Chris Farley plays, of the motivational speaker living in a van down by the river. Much more than a guy in a three-piece suit with a PowerPoint and business cards. The prophets are an interesting bunch. But they're the people that God has chosen to go and to speak to the rest of the people, to his nations, to his children. So oftentimes it's the most unlikely candidate who goes for him. Amos is interesting because he's one of the few prophets who, by all accounts, seems to be doing well, but what makes him a contentious figure is not by how he's doing or how he looks, but where he's from. I think in a divided world, we have an idea of why this passage has so much animosity built up into it. Why Amaziah? And why the king wants nothing to do with Amos. And I'll tell you one thing, apart from Amos's character, frankly, what's at the center of this text is that people just don't want to listen to a message of repentance. In fact, repentance is such a neglected word. When was the last time you said the word repent or repentance in a casual conversation? Outside of anything having to do with church or with faith, how often do we use the English word repentance? It's one of those things that's so difficult and often something we don't want to think about that, frankly, it's become an antiquated term in our language. It's pretty amazing, but it makes sense nonetheless. Repentance is a very loaded word, a very loaded idea. It's a challenging word. It's something that stares us in the face and asks much more of us than we're often comfortable enough to give. It requires humility. It requires, God forbid, a recognition that we don't have things figured out always. That's a message that we especially do not want to hear, especially as people who are looking for the good times. I read an excerpt this week from a 17th century Puritan writer whose name was Thomas Watson, who wrote in his journal what he considered to be the main substance of repentance, what it takes for true and genuine repentance to actually take place. And he said that repentance was, quote, the spiritual medicine made up of six special ingredients. He said, if any one of these is left out, it loses its virtue. And those six ingredients were, 1, sight of sin. 2, sorrow for sin. 3, confession of sin. 4, shame on behalf of sin. 5, hatred for sin. And 6, most importantly, a turning away from sin. He said that all six were required. You want to talk about another word that's fallen out of our vernacular? How oftentimes do we talk about the word sin outside of a church or theological conversation? Now, I'm thinking about everything we've been through these past couple years, and as the pandemic continues on, as the cases are rising, it's been an exhausting couple years. But I took so much joy from this text because Thomas Watson said this was the spiritual medicine of repentance. Man, I would love if repentance was as simple as giving a medical prescription. If I could just give it to you right here and say, here it is. Wouldn't that be wonderful? And believe it or not, I found this article that a pastor wrote into his Sunday morning news column, and it was a fake infomercial that was posted in a section that was called Holy Humor Sunday. And the article read in big, bold letters that kind of captured this feeling. I'm going to do my best to do an infomercial-type commercial voice. This is what it said. Do you suffer from moderate to severe sin? Is this chronic condition sweeping across communities with a current 100% transmission rate? Symptoms may include, but are not limited to, doing things you swore you wouldn't do, saying things that get you into trouble, conveniently neglecting things that should be done, and engaging in behaviors that your mother warned you not to do. If you suffer from one or more of these conditions, help is closer than you think. Call 1-800-MESSIAH. That's 1-800-MESSIAH. Speak to the renowned physician who said, I come not to call the righteous, but sinners. His prescriptions include forgiveness, confession, and free doses of sanctifying grace. Ask your pastor if repentance is right for you. Wouldn't that be awesome if that actually worked? I mean, if it was as easy as putting up an infomercial of take this medicine, receive this thing, do these six steps, and you're good to go. Unfortunately, I feel like over the past few decades, the televangelists tried that, and it did not work out. No, unfortunately, for us, repentance is more than just a six-step process. Repentance is more than an idea. It's more than just a thing that we do. Repentance is simply hard work. It's hard. It takes a willingness. It takes an intentionality. It takes a daily commitment to invest in and to engage in. And above all else, as we saw in this text, what it absolutely demands of us is a consistent faithfulness to the God that we worship and the God who offers that grace to us. You cannot have repentance if you do not have the source of forgiveness and the source of the grace that allows us to truly turn from ourselves, from our nature, from our very sin. But God's not going to do that for us. God is not going to make us repent. God invites us to walk alongside Him and to receive His grace and to do this work together, to cooperate with His Spirit, with the Holy Spirit. As the Holy Spirit works within us, He sanctifies us and works alongside us to renew ourselves, to free us from that which is holding us back. And here's another interesting thing. We tend to think of situations like Amos, and we look at the northern kingdom, and they say, oh man, look at how great they had it. Of course they had it coming from them. Most of the time we think that bad things happen to prosperous people because if you're prospering, that means something wrong is happening, which is not always the case. More times than not, when you hear that kind of criticism, it's coming from a place of envy as opposed to a place of true godliness. There were many people who we would consider prosperous for their day that were seen as faithful in and of their time. The first convert to Christianity, the first Gentile convert, was a man by the name of Cornelius. Cornelius was a Roman official. You want to talk about somebody who had status and who had wealth and probably had stability. But he was humble enough to see that this God that the Judeans were worshiping was the true God and the true creator of the world and the only place where true salvation could be found. And when he did, God sent Peter to go and to baptize him and his household to welcome the first convert, Gentile convert, into the faith of the Messiah. Abraham, another example. Abraham was well-to-do for his time. But one of the most famous passages of Abraham was whenever God comes to visit him with his angels. Abraham humbles himself, offers everything that he has before God, and treats him as an honored guest and walks alongside of him all of his days. The difference is not what one person has or does not have. The difference is way more internal than that. What set the northern kingdom on a wrong path, what set them on the path of eventual destruction, was not their prosperity, it was their love of prosperity. It wasn't their riches, it was their love for riches. It was how tightly they clung on to the things that they were enjoying during their time because of their ancestors. And they held on to it so tightly that their love for God fell by the wayside. It didn't completely go away. It was there. There was a high priest. There was worship there. But it was secondary, tertiary, way down the ladder. It was just a facade. It was something that they just did just because that's what they always did. But really, the real work was making sure that we have it together today, that our king is strong, that our nations around us are in a good place, we're not ruffling any feathers, and that we're living as respectable people, people who show a good image, but deep down their heart is obsessed with something else. And that's why this text ends the way that it ends. They don't want to repent. They had an opportunity to do it, and instead of listening to the prophet, their high priest and king, the highest authority figures in the land, tell the prophet to get out of here because we don't want to hear about your nonsense anymore. Go back to that place that you came from and prophesy there. And they rejected the invitation to repentance. This is not a story that is unfamiliar. This is our story. This is a story that we're faced with every single day. There's another story to illustrate this that I read from a well-known preacher who was talking about his dad throughout his life. This man was a preacher, but his dad wanted nothing to do with his church. He was very cynical. He frankly just thought everything that was being done that was good around him was for kind of a catch, like there was a catch-22, or there are strings attached to stuff. But let me read you his words exactly how he told the story. He said, "My mother took us to church in Sunday school. My father didn't go. He complained about Sunday dinner being late when she came home. Sometimes the preacher would call, and my father would say, 'I know what the church wants. The church doesn't care about me. The church wants another name, another pledge, another name, another pledge.'" Right? Isn't that the name of the game? Another name, another pledge? That's what he always said to me. Sometimes we'd have a revival. The pastor would bring in the evangelist and say to the evangelist, "Now there's one guy in this crowd you really need to work on. I hope you get him this time," referring to my dad. And my father would say the same thing. Every time, my mother in the kitchen, always nervous about the fear of flaring up tempers or somebody's feelings being hurt, she would keep quiet as my father would say, "The church doesn't care about me. The church wants another name, another pledge. Another name, another pledge." I guess I've heard it 1,000 times. One time he didn't say it. He was in the veterans hospital, and he was down about 73 pounds. The x-rays had burned him to pieces. He just had a tube put in. I flew in to see him. I saw him as often as I could, but he couldn't speak. He barely ate. But then he looked around the room every time I went to visit him. And across every single windowsill and every single free corner of the floor, there were flowers that laid beside the bed, flowers adorned in every color. We saw so many petals. We even had a stack of cards that were about 20 inches deep. And all the flowers beside the bed, every card, every blossom, was from a person or a group from the church that he was so cynical about. He saw me read one of the cards one day, and he still couldn't speak. So he took a Kleenex box and wrote on the side of it a line from Shakespeare. "If he had not written this line, I would not tell you this story." He wrote, "In this harsh world, draw your breath in pain to tell my story." And I said, "What is your story, Daddy?" And he wrote, "I was wrong. I was wrong." We can have good times in our present day. We can be optimistic. We can be prosperous. There are many ways that we can feel and we can establish ourselves as what we project is the case. And I don't care how faithful it is that we might have been in the past. We just celebrated the 4th of July, and I love that service. I love hearing the hymn, America the Beautiful, My Country, 'Tis of Thee, calling back to a time where we stood as a nation united under God. But here's the challenge that is facing us, that passages like this section in Amos and so many others face us with. Are we going to be faithful in the present day? Not are we, not are is this group of people, not is our culture, not is the world going to be faithful. Are you going to be faithful? Am I going to be faithful? Am I going to take the daily steps to do the work of repentance that Jesus says is what is necessary to receive the kingdom of God? Are we going to do that kind of work? Are we going to be faithful? You know, we talk about faith in the Bible so much. And most of the time when I hear people talking about faith, it's usually in this kind of category. Faith is just a belief that God is there, that he's present, that he's doing things, and somehow he's going to make things work out. That's the most common refrain of faith that I hear. But faith, I tend to think of it more from a biblical perspective of faithfulness. Faithfulness is trust. Faithfulness is a relationship. Faithfulness is a regular engagement, a willingness to never abandon a person, and the person in the Bible we're talking about is the person of God. Are we consistent in seeking out God? Is he our highest pursuit, our highest desire within our hearts? Or is it that God is putting a plumb line amongst us like he did the people of Israel? Do you know what a plumb line is? A plumb line is what architects would use to measure whether or not a wall or a structure was secure and was stable. They would hang a piece of metal, back then it was tin, from a string and put it against the wall so that gravity would keep it on a vertical line to see if the wall was standing up straight. So they could continue building whatever it is that they were building. It was a test to see how firm the foundation was of what you are trying to make. Folks, how are our structures doing today? And I'm not talking about our buildings or an actual literal structure. I'm talking about how is the temple of your body? How is your heart right now? How stable are we in this time? I know we think that nothing wrong could happen, just as the Northern Kingdom did as well. But what are the steps we're doing to do the work of repentance today, tomorrow, the next day? Are we starting out our days on our knees in prayer? Or are we starting on our own arrogance? The work of repentance is not something that we can move outside of ourselves, that we can assign to people or committees or leaders or whatever beyond our periphery. The work of repentance starts with every single individual who hears these words spoken. Here's a good test to see how repentance is doing. Where does your eyes and your ears most often go on a day-to-day basis? Every day, every week, every month. I hesitate to ask like the spouse for the other person. I won't do that. But think about it. Where does your attention most squarely lie most of the time? Is it the news? Is it a social media screen? Is it a TV screen? Is it even a good cause? There's nothing wrong with doing something good, but if you take a good thing and you raise it up to a God thing, it becomes a bad thing. You can do good works and do it for your own sake, just as the Pharisees did, and get their own reward from that, as Jesus said. And you know the ironic thing, speaking of the Pharisees? Pharisees we think about in the Gospels are kind of the antithesis to Jesus. They're always the ones that Jesus is getting into fights with, through his parables and through his teachings, and they were the ones that always tried to conspire to get him to stop talking. We think of the Pharisees as your typical, you know, religious figure who is kind of a hypocrite. But did you know that when the Pharisees began, they were seen as the paragons of Judea? They came out as a result of the exile. They formed as an intent to make sure that what happened in the past, the unfaithfulness that Israel showed that caused them to go into the exile, they were committing themselves to making sure everybody in every single village knew and practiced the word of God, the law of Moses. And that's a great thing when you think about it. They were seen as leaders. They were seen as holy people. But by the time we get to the Gospels, what happens? They fit the picture that Jesus paints of a cup that's being cleaned on the outside, but on the inside, quote, they are full of self-indulgence. My message today is a simple one. It's not even really a message, it's an invitation. It's an invitation for me and for you, for all of us, to do the work of repentance, to embrace repentance, because it's absolutely worth it. It's something that I promise you that if we strive together in stumbling forward to our goal, our true goal, which is God and His work, as Jesus said, to seek His kingdom first, then I promise you all of these other circumstances are going to line in place. God is forgiving, He works with us, and He walks alongside us. That does not mean that we don't stumble. That doesn't mean that we don't sin. That doesn't mean we don't make mistakes from time to time. But it does ask the question of, what is your goal? Where are you going? Where does your heart truly lie? Things can be different. The times can change. We can see the change, but it's not going to start outside of us. It starts with you and me. May we be a people of forgiveness. May we be a people with not blind eyes turned, but eyes open, seeking the prize, fixed ultimately towards our Lord and towards His kingdom. May we be a people of repentance. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. And now, as we respond to these words, let us start with a place of worship. I invite you to stand and let us sing to God and what He's done.
And I heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like. And I heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. Who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. And I see many searching for answers afar and wide, and I know that we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect. All of your ways, you are perfect in all of your ways. undeniable. I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable. I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still into love. Love. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. Who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Love so undeniable, peace so inexplainable. These are the fruits of the work of the faithful. This is the outcome of those who dedicate their lives to Christ, to seek repentance in our day, to seek God's holiness and grace and truth above all that the world could ever offer. We have a good, good Father. We have someone who has not abandoned nor forsaken us, but a Father, a Creator, who walks alongside us even in the darkest days. Accept His call, friends. Walk alongside Him. And rest knowing that the arms of our Savior are wide open to receive us wherever we are. His grace is sufficient. His love never fails. So friends, go forth in peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, we pray. By His power and mercy, may we be transformed to be instruments of His power, to be citizens of His kingdom, and to be children in His family now and forevermore. Amen. God bless you all.
You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. Yes, you are perfect in all of your ways. Perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Thank y'all for being with us this week. Y'all have a blessed week. Thank you so much. We'll see you next week.